Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Captured in Flames by Susan Eileen. Narrated by Marguerite Gavin. Chapter 1. Bailey. People thought slaying dragons was a glamorous job full of danger and excitement. Sure, I could take a beating far better than the average person. Fire couldn't burn me, and I had super strength. But all that good stuff came with some significant downsides. Today was a prime example of the horrors I faced in my line of work. Snot covered me. Icky, gooey snot. And lots of it. The green dragon in front of me huffed, puffed, and blew out a monstrous sneeze that had to have stirred a hurricane down in the Gulf, never mind that we were in Oklahoma. The shock wave ran over me, stumbling me back and leaving my hair and clothes dripping in green goo. My stomach twisted, bile rising into my throat. I fought it down and blinked a few times to clear my vision. The first time that happened, I nearly died. I'd been inside a building when a dragon released a torrent of snot, soaking everything in sight from the ceiling to the floor. The beast recovered faster than me. I kept losing my balance on the wet floor and hurling every time my face planted in the goo. At least today I stood in the middle of a large parking lot with open air so I could maneuver out of the mess. The past week had been more than a little rough. A nasty cold had spread through the dragon community, making my job more difficult than usual. It was supposed to be rare for the beasts to get sick, but I'd since learned that they were more vulnerable to illness during late winter and early spring. They were still adjusting to their return to Earth almost a year ago, and were more susceptible to changes in their environment. Our planet was far different from Cadarwin, a barren landscape with little vegetation where all dragons had lived for 1,000 years after a group of sorcerers banished them from our dimension. To make matters worse, the spring weather in Oklahoma couldn't decide if it wanted to be chilly or warm. The dragons would venture out on a nice day, only to get smacked by a cold front later that evening. Their bodies couldn't handle anything close to freezing temperatures, and we had a much higher pollen count than they'd encountered before. Seeing them suffer would have been funny if it didn't have such hazardous consequences for me. I took a washcloth from the pouch on my leg harness, the third I'd used that day, and wiped the worst of the snot off my face. It was in my hair as well, but I'd found keeping it in a French braid helped minimize the amount that stuck. The greenish goo smelled sort of like Play-Doh, though the consistency was much stickier. I grew up on a ranch as the only girl with 3 brothers and didn't shy away from yucky stuff, but I didn't think anything could have prepared me for dragon snot. It took gross to a whole new level. The beast before me snorted, and a small flame puffed from its nose. One advantage to my prey being ill was that it severely stunted its fire-breathing capabilities. Sick dragons couldn't roar out flames the way they usually did, which made things easier for me. I might not burn, but a wall of fire could blind me so I wouldn't see an attack coming. My current adversary had an annoyed look in its red eyes when it failed to produce a decent flame. "Performance problems?" I asked, not knowing if it understood me. Some of them had picked up English, but not many. I gripped my sword, prepared for what would come next, and didn't move when the dragon leaped forward, claws outstretched. Waiting until the last moment, I ducked and then rammed the tip of my blade straight under its chin to the roof of its mouth. I didn't have the strength to get any farther. Dragon bone was rock hard, but I had another weapon. While my enemy swiped and clawed at its neck, trying to get free, I rolled under its body and stabbed a shorter blade between its ribs and into its heart. The beast groaned and shuddered. That was my cue to scramble away as fast as I could. As I rose to a crouch several feet away, It let out one last huff and slumped to the ground, wings unfurling almost to my feet. If I'd been underneath the body, it would have crushed me. This particular green dragon was about the size of a small elephant and weighed at least as much. The neck was several feet long, and the tail was the length of a truck. All in all, it must have been at least 10 times my size. Since completing the Slayer rite of passage last year, I'd evolved physically into something much stronger and more durable than the average human, but I still had vulnerabilities. My bones could still break with enough pressure, and I needed to breathe like everyone else. Loud clapping sounded behind me. I turned and found Conrad standing about 100 feet away near a large storefront with blown-out windows. My friend and sidekick wore a big grin as he walked toward me, boots crunching on broken glass. We'd chosen to hunt in a place once known as Crossroads Mall, since many dragons were nesting there and killing the humans who lived nearby. The location was also convenient because it was just over the border from our safe zone, where the green beasts couldn't enter, making it a shorter traveling distance. I tried to avoid driving far in my truck, considering gasoline was fast running out in a post-apocalyptic world, and going anywhere from our home base in Norman took a lot. There weren't many resources left for getting fuel. The 20-year-old man before me was one of my most loyal friends. Conrad was of average height and build, with dark skin, brown eyes, and a close-shaven head. Though the young guy was very well-toned, most wouldn't have thought he could fight dragons any more than me, a notably petite woman. But he had plenty of courage, and had recently become fireproof. Not because my friend was a dragon slayer, that was a genetic trait he didn't inherit. Rather, he'd been gifted his flame resistance last fall, when we'd gone on a quest to recover the fragments from a magical orb. No man could have been happier to gain that ability. Conrad rarely let me go out hunting without him anymore, living for the thrill of killing dragons. "Good job, Bailey," he said, then gestured toward the side of the building. "I got another one waiting for you over there." I glanced over, catching sight of a green dragon with its mouth and snout looped with rope. Its tail swished angrily from side to side as it smashed holes into a nearby store wall. Debris flew with every strike, as if everything wasn't trashed enough already. The rope and grappling hooks holding the beast were something we'd acquired from a local sorcerer, and Conrad found a way to make them work for him. Dragons couldn't burn or break through the special rigging, so all my battle partner had to do was bind them up for me to finish. Easy job, right? Not exactly, but my sidekick had a knack for leaping on the beast's backs and tying them up. A mechanical bull would have been nothing for him if he ever got the chance to try one out. Conrad didn't have my super strength to punch through a dragon's hide and scales, so he didn't bother with blades often, and instead trussed them up for me to strike the final blow. I nodded at him. "Thanks, I got it." Not wasting another moment. Sometimes they did manage to escape if given enough time. I rushed over to the squirming dragon. It bucked hard as soon as it saw me. I'd been coming up to the south end of Oklahoma City to hunt a lot recently, and they were beginning to recognize my face. Pickings had become slim where I lived in Norman. As a slayer, I couldn't go between kills for long, or else there would be consequences. It was the curse of my kind that we had a constant need to kill fire-breathing beasts. A week was about as long as I could make it before my iron control slipped, and that wasn't a good thing, since I was in a serious relationship with a dragon. Well, he was half of one. Aidan wasn't pure like the ones I fought today, but rather a shifter. He could look like a regular person, except for his eyes, which were yellow-gold with a slight feral glint to them. His breed was rare, and only made up about 10% of the entire world's dragon population. I didn't get an itch to kill him in his human form, but it took concentration to hold myself back when he was a beast. If I went too long without fighting others of his kind, he began to look like prey. The last thing I wanted was to kill the love of my life. On the other hand, pure dragons needed their population thinned as much as possible. I stared at the bound creature before me, watching it struggle harder as I stepped in front of it. One of the grappling hooks dug into its neck and another into its right foreleg. Conrad's rope work didn't appear neat and pretty, but it did the job. Pain and fear shone in the beast's eyes. "I'll make this quick," I said. Not wanting to make the dragon suffer any longer, I pulled a dagger from my belt and struck down on a soft spot behind its skull. This method wasn't easy since I had to aim for a target no wider than my blade, but it was the quickest and most painless way to take them out. Still, it took all my strength to punch through the thick hide and scales, deep into the brain. A tiny spurt of blood came out, and then the dragon's head slumped to the ground. A small part of me felt terrible at that moment for taking a life, even that of a predator, but each kill hardened me a bit more. I'd been fighting them since last August, 8 months now, and the compassion that once filled me diminished the longer I hunted. What would I be like in a few more years, assuming I survived that long? Dragon slayers didn't have the best survival rates, despite the fact they couldn't age, and few made it past their first few years of fighting.
"They don't deserve your sympathy,"
a deep-timbered voice said from behind. I jerked my dagger out and spun to face my father, who was holding a dragon head in his right hand. Blood dripped from the slain creature's open mouth and neck. Wayne had been fighting the beasts for a lot longer than me, and it showed in the hardened expression on his face. The man appeared somewhere in his 40s, but he was closer to 60. He didn't complete his rite of passage until later in life, so at least he looked experienced, whereas I would be stuck at 22 years old forever, since that's when I became a slayer. My father was much bigger than me, and actually looked like a man who could kill dragons with his large, muscular build and fierce brown eyes. His black hair was down to his shoulders, loose and wild after his latest kills. He was half Cherokee, and he'd seen a lot of sun, giving his skin a weathered appearance. I wasn't too different in complexion, since I'd inherited some of his Native American traits, as well as being a quarter Malaysian on my mother's side. The other half of me was of white European ancestry, but no one could ever figure out my genetic mix unless I told them. My father was a legend among dragonkind for his killer prowess. They feared him, often fleeing at the mere hint he could be nearby. When we hunted together, he always let me go in first, so that he wouldn't scare off the prey before I had them distracted. Not that it was totally necessary, since he was a master of sneaking up on the beasts. I hadn't gotten that sly yet, and sometimes gave us away before we could attack. He was slowly teaching me the art of stealth. Today, he'd gone to the opposite end of the mall so we wouldn't hinder each other. God only knew how many kills he'd made in the last hour. I'd heard sporadic dragon screams, but that didn't reveal much. Sometimes his prey never got a chance to make a sound. I narrowed my eyes. I prefer to keep some of my humanity, thank you.
"There is still no need to be soft with the beasts," he said, his lips thinning.
Until last fall, I didn't even know who my father was, or if he was alive, since he disappeared before I was born. It wasn't until he saved my life after I attacked a dragon nest beyond my skill level that I met him. We had a lot of tension between us at first, especially because of my relationship with a shifter, but then Wayne came to stay at my house last Christmas. During his visit,
He, Aidan, Conrad, and I fought two insanely powerful rogues together. It took all of us working as a team to kill them, and in the process, my father came to accept my different way of life. He still didn't get it entirely, though. You don't just lose your humanity toward one kind of creature, I said, wiping my blade with a cloth. If you lose it, your compassion for everything fades. He worked his jaw.
Is that how you see me? Too far gone?
Well, I shifted from foot to foot. You've still got a bit of soul left, but you could definitely lighten up. Wayne's lips twitched.
I have since found you.
His words made me feel warm and fuzzy inside. When I first met him, I didn't think there would be any hope of building a relationship, but we had slowly gotten closer over the last few months. He'd been living in Tulsa until recently. It wasn't until December that he'd decided the other two slayers up there, new like me, could handle things without him. After that, he'd come to help manage the dragon population in Oklahoma City. We joined together once or twice a week and took out the larger nests that would be difficult to do alone.
That's so sweet, Conrad said, joining us. Guess I won't need any sugar in my coffee later.
Of course, my sidekick usually joined us in our family hunt, often providing comedic relief. My father rolled his eyes and tossed the dragon ahead at the young man.
Find some place to put this.
Seriously, man? You like this beheading shit too much and need to find a new hobby.
Fishing or something.
Conrad threw the head back at Wayne.
I'm with Bailey on keeping some of my humanity.
My father tucked the dragon head under his arm, likely planning to post it somewhere later as a warning to others. Or maybe he'd put it on a wall. Who knew? Since he hadn't invited me, I'd yet to visit his new home.
I do fish. Sometimes.
My eyes rounded.
You fish? I find it relaxing, and it gives me something fresh to eat,
he said, shrugging.
I learn something new about him every day.
Do you do anything else to relax?
Nothing I want to discuss.
Conrad and I glanced at each other, wondering what that meant. Wayne wouldn't tell us unless he wanted to, so I wouldn't try pushing him. He could be more than a little secretive. Getting to know my father was like peeling away the layers of an onion one at a time, and took a lot of effort and patience, but it was worth it to catch glimpses of what he hid inside.
How many dragons did you kill today, man?
Conrad asked, wisely changing the subject. He'd gotten to know my father a bit as well. Wayne frowned.
8, I believe.
Nice work, I said. He'd taken down more than I could ever hope to do in an hour. I got 3 and thought that was good.
Technically, you finished 2 of mine, too,
Conrad pointed out. My father studied me, pride and concern in his gaze.
You'll get better and faster with time. This isn't a competition. Even if your friend here thinks otherwise, the 2 I trained in Tulsa could not have done better than you today.
Conrad stiffened.
There ain't nothing wrong with keeping count. Gotta impress the ladies somehow.
Ever since he broke up with Christine in early December, he'd been on a rash of one-night stands. I rarely saw him at night. With his reputation for fighting dragons, a surprising number of women were happy to hook up with him. Who knew he could get lucky so much in a post-apocalyptic world? Wayne's gaze jerked to the horizon, and he stiffened.
Your mate is here.
Are you sure? I asked, following his line of sight and not seeing anything. Aidan was supposed to be doing patrols on the western border today. It was dangerous for a shifter to enter pure dragon territory, and we were about a half mile into their land. I-240 in Oklahoma City made up the northern border between the Taugud, shifters, and the Shadowin, pure dragons. If he got caught on this side of the interstate, they'd kill him.
He's walking from there,
My father pointed to the southeast.
Must have stayed in neutral territory as long as possible before shifting and crossing.
The interstates were considered strips of territory where any dragon could move along without repercussions from the neighboring clans. Still, anyone traveling on them could attack anyone else they found and violate no laws or treaties. The old crossroads mall was at the corner of two neutral paths, I-35 and I-240, making it an extra dangerous area. We hurried to meet Aidan, knowing he wouldn't have taken the risk to come here without an important reason. I noted that his thick black hair had gotten a bit windblown. It was medium length and reached just above his striking yellow eyes. He had a light olive complexion and a lean, toned body. The shifter walked with confidence, strength, and grace, despite being in enemy territory. I'd never met another guy like him, and knew I'd never want anyone else. "What are you doing here?" I asked, starting to hug him before remembering the dragon's snot covering me. It wouldn't make me sick, but it could affect him. His gaze ran up and down my body, checking for wounds the way he always did after I hunted. He lingered on a deep gash on my cheek. His hand rose to touch it, stopping short of contact. The wound would fully heal within a few hours, but he still didn't like to see me hurt. Aidan's jaw clenched for a moment before he forced himself to relax.
"The Pendragon wants you at the fortress right away. It can't wait."
"Why? What's going on?" He looked to my father and Conrad, hesitating.
"We should speak alone."
I sighed. It's okay to speak in front of them. I trust them. A few more seconds passed before he finally replied.
"Gade found another page from his tome, and we think it pertains to you."
Oh, damn. That didn't sound good. Chapter 2. Bailey. "The mysterious book with his predictions?" I asked incredulously. It was a book Aidan's uncle had written long ago. The process had taken years and put him in strange fugue states while he transcribed the text. After completing it, he forgot everything he'd recorded onto the pages, and then it went missing. Until now, they'd only found one page. It had sent us on a long, dangerous journey to recover an ancient orb that could allow a sorcerer to control dragons and slayers. We'd barely survived traveling hundreds of miles, including crossing through two pure dragon clan territories. Conrad and Danny got the best end of the deal since they became fireproof at our last stop. But we all became bound to protect the orb and keep it from falling into the hands of a power-hungry sorcerer. Too bad we didn't know for sure which sorcerer that was, or their location. We only had our suspicions for now. Aidan nodded.
"Yes, that book." "What's the page say?"
Conrad asked.
"I have no idea. They sent me straight here after finding it."
My faithful sidekick lifted his chin.
"I'm going with you. I want to know what this is about, and you ain't keeping me out of it." "No."
Aidan shook his head.
"The Pendragon made it clear he only wanted Bailey."
"Fuck him."
Conrad put his hands on his hips.
"I don't trust that dude not to do something to her if he doesn't like what the page says."
I gave him a reassuring look. "You don't know that it will be anything bad.
If he wants you there right this damned second, it can't be good."
Aidan ran a hand through his dark hair.
"I'll be there, and trust me, I can protect her better than you."
That was what I counted on, him being there. I hated pandering to the Pendragon, but for the sake of Aidan and his clan, I tried to cooperate. It would only cause more trouble to refuse the summons. My father's expression turned fierce, and he crossed his arms.
"I could do even better."
"Dad, you know they'll never let you into the shifter fortress," I said, giving him a gentle smile.
the kind ones saved for ferocious beasts on the verge of attack. But I'll be fine. They need me for the coming war and would never hurt me. He grimaced. Wayne didn't like it that I would fight with the shifters in an invasion in Texas sometime soon, exact dates to be determined. But he also understood my reasons. I'd been trying to return to my mother and family for nearly a year. Helping to win the war was the only way I could do it. Aidan's clan and another clan to the south had signed a treaty last fall, becoming allies after centuries of cutting ties. Their deal included them working together to expand the Faygood's territory into central Texas. In return, the Taugood would get assistance against any threats to the north. There were other parts to the agreement, but that was the one that mattered to me. I'd met with the Faygood during Christmas time, winning their Pendragon over so I could get home if I also helped.
Fine, but I still don't like it,
my father growled. I know, I said, appreciating his concern, but it'll be all right.
I'll be waiting at your house, and you better be fine when I see you later.
I shook my head. There's no need to...
I'll be there too,
Conrad said, puffing his chest.
This ain't only about you, no matter what they think.
Good grief. The men in my life could be overbearing. One would never guess I was a formidable dragon slayer by how they treated me, but I suppose it made me feel loved. There were worse problems to have than protective friends and family. Fine, I'll see you guys later. Aidan nodded at Conrad and my father.
I will return her safely. See that you do,
Wayne warned. I tossed my truck keys at Conrad. Get it back safely.
No problem,
he said. It wasn't the first time I'd entrusted him with my vehicle, and I knew it would be waiting at my house later. Aidan gestured, and we started walking back in the direction he came. You shifted to human form before crossing Shadowen territory, right?
Yes.
The pure dragons in Oklahoma were all green, and shifters in Aidan's clan were red. There is also a significant size difference between them, pure being 2 to 3 times larger, as well as physical characteristics such as shifters having shorter necks and more human-like arms. If he entered Shadowen territory in his beast form, they'd notice him right away. He'd had to make that part of the journey as a human to avoid getting caught. They wouldn't know the difference as long as they didn't get close enough to smell him or see his eyes. Aidan kept us moving fast as we walked quickly toward the interstate. It was all I could do to keep up, but I couldn't blame him for not wanting to linger. Should he be caught, it wouldn't just mean us having to fight. It could be considered a violation of the treaty between his clan, the Taugood, and the Shadowen. There needed to be peace for now between them, since the shifters would be fighting a different pure dragon clan in the south soon. Will you fly me once we cross? I asked as we neared the interstate.
Of course,
he grimaced at me.
After we clean you up.
I checked from east to west, spotting a couple of green dragons flying nearby. Aidan guided us to an underpass so we wouldn't have to go through neutral territory where we could easily be seen. Halfway under the bridge, I caught sight of a man huddled under a blanket. The sun would be setting soon, and the air was cooling. I saw a lot of homeless people during my hunts for dragons. Many of them couldn't stand to sleep inside a house where a dragon might decide to burn the place down if they suspected someone was inside. It had happened often since their return to Earth. I dug into a pouch on my leg harness and pulled out a granola bar. It was a precious commodity since food supplies were low, but I couldn't help a random act of kindness now and then. The man looked up when we got close, and there was an expression of hopelessness in his eyes. That was another thing I saw a lot lately. People were scared, worn out, and losing faith that life would get any better. This one hadn't shaved in months, and his brown hair was haggard and long. It was hard to tell his age since he was on the emaciated side, but I estimated he was only in his 30s. "Here," I said, handing him the granola bar. He stared at me for a moment before snatching it from my grasp. Food inside grocery stores was long gone, and most trees and plants wouldn't produce fruits and vegetables for a while yet. People were starving everywhere if they hadn't hoarded enough to last the winter. Some chose to steal or even kill for food, but others had lost the will to live and waited for death. He coughed.
"Thanks."
Aidan and I continued moving and came out from under the bridge, blinking at the bright sunlight. I breathed a sigh of relief. Crossing the border always felt even riskier than being in pure dragon territory. Demolished cars, burn holes, and rotting corpses littered the interstate to remind everyone, dragons and humans alike, of how dangerous it could be to anyone who passed through there. No one used those stretches of highway unless they absolutely had to, and only as long as needed. Aidan led me farther into shifter territory until we got behind some buildings where we'd be out of sight. It was quiet, with only the wind rustling through the trees nearby to break the silence. Not even the birds chirped. We were still too close to the border to see any activity except the occasional dragon patrol, but even they weren't around at the moment.
"We must get you clean,"
he said, wiggling his nose at my snot-covered garb. The tight pants and halter top I wore looked similar to black leather, but the outfit was really made of camrium, a fireproof cloth Aidan had designed for me with additional sorcerer spells cast on it so it could protect against blades and bullets. It was much more flexible than leather, which was important when one needed to move easily and quickly in a fight. More than once, the warrior garb had saved my life. I looked to the left and right, confused. Since the dragon cold had started spreading, I'd been bathing at our home before he returned at night from patrols. This problem hadn't come up before. There's not exactly a shower around here for me to use, or even a pond for that matter.
"Stay close as I shift, and the flames will burn you clean,"
he instructed. "Wow," I cocked my head. "Why have you not mentioned this nifty trick before?" Every night this week, I'd had to station myself at a wash basin in the cold outdoors and scrub myself for an hour to get all the snot and gunk off my clothes, hair, and body. Never mind collecting the ton of water I'd needed for that. And all along there'd been a faster way that would have left me totally sterilized of germs.
"The opportunity didn't present itself until now."
"Oh, right. Our schedules weren't really in alignment." "Good point." He moved closer until we almost touched and shifted from a human to a dragon. The first time I saw him transform, I was terrified. But I'd grown used to the process. Flames licked up his body, fanning against me as I turned in a circle to get fully covered. I could just make out a shadowy figure within as it stretched and grew into beast form. After a minute, the fire subsided, and a red dragon emerged. It was still a bit frightening to see him this way, but I'd learned to love the man and the beast. I dropped my gaze to inspect myself and couldn't find a speck of snot on me, and even my hair felt soft and clean. That was one impressive sterilization process. I smiled at Aidan and wagged a finger. "I won't forget you can do this." He opened his arms, covered in rough red scales, and I let him wrap them around me. The urge to attack niggled at the back of my mind, but I quelled it with little effort. When he took off into the air, I let myself relish flying through the sky. No human could do this, at least not without a protective blanket. But a dragon's hot touch didn't burn me any more than their fire, so I was safe. Aidan took us over the south end of Oklahoma City, across Moore, and finally into Norman. Damage from the dragon invasion was far easier to see from above, and it was numerous. So many wrecked cars, burned houses, and debris cluttering the roads that I thought it would take forever to clean up if we ever reached a stage where we could get the city back in order. That certainly wouldn't be any time soon, maybe not ever. I tried to forget the world as it once was, because whenever I did think of things like pizza, ice cream, movies, computers, and all the other joys of modern life, it was like a black hole would try to swallow me up. The only way to survive and thrive now was to face the fact the world would never be the same. The Shifter Fortress was southeast of town, near Lake Thunderbird in a valley. When it came into view, I let out a gasp. I hadn't visited the place recently, and hadn't realized how beautiful the landscape was in the spring. The fields surrounding it were green, except for a scorched area where the shifters landed and changed forms. Trees were growing new leaves and flowers. The mountains beyond the fortress rose to soaring heights and gave the place a magnificent backdrop. Those craggy peaks hadn't been there until the dimensions collided and caused extreme earth terrain changes. I also spotted a new village near the high walls. Aidan had told me about it, but this was my first time seeing it. After last Christmas, when the shifters started to win over the local populations, humans had begun seeking refuge at the fortress. Many were starving, and had heard they could get food, shelter, and safety if they asked for it. The keep was overflowing, so the Pendragon ordered a village built outside the walls. Progress had been slow at first due to freezing temperatures, but they must have picked up the pace during the last few weeks since I last visited. I was impressed with how far they'd come and counted at least 20 houses, plus a few shops already open for business. There were even some small gardens behind a few homes, which would help people gain a semblance of self-sufficiency. As for the fortress itself, it could be somewhat intimidating. It had been constructed with dark gray stone. The outer wall rose to 30 feet high, and there were 4 guard towers, one at each corner. Along the ramparts, there was a series of jagged spikes designed to tear into a dragon's wings if they came too close. These same spikes were on roofs and anywhere else that stood tall. Those protections ensured nothing except small birds could fly into the keep without getting severely injured. The castle in the middle took center stage. It was huge, also made of dark gray stone, and stood higher than everything else. The windows were tall and narrow, but walkways were at the top of the 3rd level where the Pendragon and his family lived. They could sit out there to enjoy the view if they liked, though I'd never seen them do it. Most of my visits included the dungeons where I was out of sight from the shifters, many of whom feared or hated me. Aidan touched down on what I mentally referred to as the dragon landing pad. I waited until he changed back to human form, noting several sets of eyes on me. Some of the shifters were out training on the field. They'd noted my arrival and stopped what they were doing. "So, where are we going today?" I asked. Aidan nodded toward the front gate.
"The Pendragon's office."
"Really?" I lifted a brow. "He trusts me in the main castle?" He quirked his lips.
"Not entirely. But I told him you didn't deserve any more visits to the dungeons."
"Thanks. I appreciate that," I said, taking his hand when he offered it. Their underground holding cells made me think of a medieval prison, except probably cleaner. The gate guards in their form-fitting black Camryum uniforms stiffened when we came close, but neither challenged us as we passed. Upon entering the keep, I found it packed with shifters and humans moving along the main stone path. There were shops and homes everywhere, often 2 stories high and looking like something out of an old-world village, except they used thinly cut stone shingles for their roofs rather than thatch.
Dried vegetation definitely would have been a bad idea in a dragon village. People stared at me, but at least no one attacked, snarled, or ran screaming. They did make a point of getting out of our way quickly. We made it to the castle, and Aidan picked up the pace as we moved through the great hall. Servants were setting up for the midday meal, which would have been dinner for humans, but dragons lived on a different schedule. Whatever they were cooking in the back kitchens, it smelled amazing. Even with all the stares, I would have been happy to stay and eat. Aidan and I often cooked pretty good meals, but we weren't super chefs and kept it simple. That was usually enough for us. Soon we came to a corridor and followed it for a minute before making a turn, and then another prior to reaching a large, imposing door. Aidan knocked. We let go of each other's hands and stood waiting, stiff and nervous. Nenok wasn't a bad leader, but he was strict and imposing.
"Enter,"
he barked. We opened the door and stepped inside, finding a room full of people. The Pendragon sat behind his desk, large and daunting with an unyielding expression on his face. He had short black military-style cut hair, yellow shifter eyes with a black slit in the middle, and medium olive skin. Nanak was one of those men that, looking at him, you knew right away he was a leader. Before taking over the shifter clan, he'd been captain of the guard and stringent in his duties. Every time I was in his presence, I fought the urge to either attack or back away. He could be more than a little intimidating, even to a slayer. Despite our differences, though, we held a grudging respect for each other. On the right side of the room, five men and women of advanced age stood in front of a weapons display. Their presence was noteworthy, because shifters stayed looking young until around the last century of their life, when the gray hairs and wrinkles finally set into their features. I could only guess that Nanak had called in the elders to witness our meeting. Cade, Aidan's uncle, was also there and stood on the left side of the room. Unlike the elders, he was only beginning to show signs of age. Most people would have estimated him to be about 50, but I'd learned he was closer to 900. His hair was black and wavy, reaching his shoulders and framing his narrow face. When I'd first met the man, he'd been a bit soft and out of shape from the tight restrictions on his movements, but he'd toned in recent months since being freed from the library. Aidan's father, who was Cade's brother, kept him confined there for centuries after becoming Pendragon. He'd deemed him mad because of his behavior during his fugue states. He wasn't genuinely crazy, but he did seem a bit off at times. Nanak had freed him after taking over and trusted Cade's predictions, especially after the first had proven true. Aidan's uncle gave me a wan smile that didn't reach his eyes. The man had always been friendly with me in the past and usually greeted me with a grin. His weak reception made me extra nervous about this meeting. I clenched my fists as the Pendragon leveled his gaze on me.
"Cade has brought it to my attention that you may be a threat to my people."
Aidan and I exchanged grim looks. This was not good. Not at all. "I'm sorry, but..." I gaped at him. "What?"
Chapter 3. Bailey. The Pendragon glanced down at a weathered page on his desk, gesturing at it.
"If this is to be understood, you could bring about the demise of my Torek."
Torek was the dragon word for clan. He was implying I'd destroy the very same clan that Aidan belonged to, which was ludicrous considering I'd done nothing except help and fight alongside them. Over and over, I'd done my best to keep them safe. "What?" My jaw dropped. "I wouldn't do that." I couldn't believe what he suggested, and stood there gaping in shock.
I had never made any threats toward him or his people. Aside from Aidan's brother, Ruari, who could drive anyone to want to kill him, no one could blame me there.
With all due respect, my lord,
Cade said, clearing his throat.
Bailey could also be part of our salvation and save us from our enemies. My writing was not entirely clear on the matter. We must consider both possibilities.
I took a deep breath. What exactly does the page say?
It is in our native tongue.
Nanak held up the parchment for me to see, revealing a bunch of weird scrawls that I couldn't hope to decipher.
I'm afraid this passage does not translate well.
This was ridiculous. How was I supposed to defend myself if they didn't give me any specifics? So explain it to me.
It is not that simple.
Aidan grunted.
Give it to me.
The Pendragon hesitated before handing it over. He skimmed over the scrawling script that looked like something similar to Phoenician. For a couple of minutes, silence reigned in the room. I dug my fingernails into my palms as Aidan's brows knitted deeper and deeper. When he reached the bottom, he stood unmoving before finally turning to meet my gaze.
Only half this page pertains to you, but it is disconcerting,
he said, working his jaw. Nanak nodded.
Exactly my point.
That's not very helpful. I crossed my arms. Give me the abbreviated version of what it says. Good grief. Was that too much to ask for when they accused me of something I hadn't done and didn't plan to do? Aidan returned his attention to the page.
I will translate as closely as possible,
he said, speaking slowly.
The female killer of dragons, lover of one such beast, will slay her mate's enemies to the south and ensure victory. But beware. If she has not the strength of mind and will, she will later become the downfall of her allies when a twisted, or perhaps demented, sorcerer arrives.
I frowned. What does that mean?
Your mind is not strong enough to resist a sorcerer's control, which we already knew. That makes you a liability. Yet, according to this, we must continue using you for the near future despite the risk.
The Pendragon shook his head.
It leaves us in a dreadful position.
I'd wondered why he'd allowed me into the castle and his office if he saw me as a threat, but this explained it. For now, the prediction clearly stated that they were safe and even needed me. Only after the upcoming war ended did we have to start worrying. I lifted my chin. Anyone could have their mind manipulated by a sorcerer. It's not like I'm the only one. Aidan cleared his throat.
Yes and no. All shifters undergo training from the time we're fully grown to withstand such manipulations. So it is not a problem for most of our people, except our youth, and a few whose minds couldn't handle the training for one reason or another.
He'd never mentioned this before, but I hadn't thought to ask either. They weren't wrong that I was vulnerable. Last year a sorceress, Verena, had been messing with my head and my friend Danny's. Xanath, a clan sorcerer, had helped clear our minds from her tampering, but he'd said it could happen again. So teach me how to protect myself, I argued, running my gaze around the room to include the elders. They'd been murmuring to themselves in the dragon language for the last few minutes, which was seriously rude. One of the females, gray hair and a braid down her back, shook her head.
It's not that simple. Our people spend years training in the art before becoming competent at it. At best, you have a month or so to master such a skill, which is impossible.
Oh, really? I asked, putting my hands on my hips. Most people wouldn't think a slayer could walk through a fortress full of dragons without attacking, but here I am.
No one believed Aidan and I could live together peacefully and love each other, but we do. Do you need more examples? Nothing is impossible if you just try hard enough.
Perhaps, she said, dipping her chin. But this is one instance where we cannot be wrong.
Another elder grunted. He stooped over so far that I didn't know how he didn't fall onto the floor.
And why should we take the risk?
Because I've been helping you guys, and I've done everything possible to prove I'm no threat to your people, I argued. He stared at me with a coldness that chilled me.
You are lucky my brethren are softer than me. If I'd had my way, we'd have executed you last year before you could mate with one of our own.
The look in his eyes revealed a depth of pain behind the anger. I'm sorry, I said, shaking my head. He frowned.
What? Why?
For that kind of hatred, a slayer must have hurt you before. I shook my head, but I wouldn't do that. To you or anyone in your Toric, even if it seems impossible, I'm asking to learn mind control because I want to be strong and not hurt you all. His lips clamped shut and he looked away.
You don't understand what you're asking,
Nanak said, resignation in his tone.
No one has ever mastered the skill in a month. The shortest period I have seen is 6 months, and that was with a shifter who was a great prodigy.
There was pity in his eyes as he spoke. It was easier to handle the man when he was cold and condescending. I could fight that much easier than when the Pendragon showed a little empathy. At least give me the chance to train. And regardless, if the battle in Texas is successful, I'll be staying there. I won't be a threat to you all from that far away.
Don't be so sure,
Cade said, sighing.
The sorcerer could find you anywhere you go. Considering this person must be powerful, and he could easily direct you to return to us. There isn't enough information to ascertain for certain how you could harm our clan, other than it will occur after the upcoming battle.
What do you mean, he? I asked. We'd considered Verena the big bad. She'd caused us the most trouble so far, and had been the one who manipulated my mind before. Cade gestured at the page Nanak had set back on his desk.
The dragon language includes gender for nouns. The text clearly states that the sorcerer we must fear is male, not female.
That was good news and bad. Our suspicions were wrong, which put our prime suspect out of the running. But that meant we had to watch for someone we'd never met. Or had we? Could it be Javier? He was an independent sorcerer who had carved out his territory in downtown Norman. The guy was a bit shady, but he'd kept his word on every deal I'd made with him so far. Not only that, but the Taugut had worked out a treaty with him. They claimed it was easier than trying to get rid of someone with that strong of a foothold in the area. He'd built quite a powerful base, with many human followers to strengthen his magic. But surprisingly, he hadn't used his position for any ill purposes yet. Maybe because he'd grown up on Earth without powers for a long time before gaining them.
Interestingly, he is ruled out by the second half of the page,
Aidan replied, frowning.
It describes a sorcerer that could only be him as an ally we must keep close. That came as a surprise to us all,
Nanak added, perplexed. Aidan gestured at the page.
Where was the parchment found?
I knew what he was thinking. Could Javier have planted it, since it seemed awfully convenient he got cleared of suspicion? Maybe he was the big bad after all. Cade rubbed the back of his head.
I found it in an old, anatomy tome that had fallen behind a shelf in the library and been lost for a long time.
Anatomy? I asked, then blushed. All right, never mind. The book must have been the shifter version of porn by the looks on everyone else's faces. No one could quite meet my eyes, which would have been funny under different circumstances. Nana cleared his throat.
The point is that Javier has been nowhere near the fortress and could not have somehow magically sent it to the library. We have defenses to prevent such occurrences from happening.
I rubbed my face. Okay, fine. But regardless, there's no reason not to let me learn how to protect my mind. I should have started the training right after we discovered what Verena did to me, and would have asked if I'd known it was possible.
Let her do it,
Aidan said, running his gaze between the elders and Nanak.
It can't hurt.
The Pendragon worked his jaw.
I suppose that is true. But if we are to sanction it, she should begin immediately. Every moment she trains could make a difference.
I nodded. For once, we can agree. The last thing I wanted was to be the downfall of Aidan's clan. Sure, they were dragons, and technically my enemies, but they were also the people of the man I loved. I would do whatever I could to protect them, including from myself.
The elders must sanction it as well,
Nanak added, gesturing at the group.
With the ramifications this has, I cannot give permission alone.
I wondered how often the council had been involved in decisions about me. I took a deep breath and looked at each one's face. Please. They turned to discuss the topic amongst each other, in the dragon language, of course. Several minutes passed with what sounded like a hot debate. Glancing at Aidan, I noted he didn't look too worried. The female elders seemed to be winning the argument, and I'd gotten the impression she might be on my side. Finally, she turned toward me.
It is agreed you may train, but we should warn you.
About what? I asked.
An accelerated program will be quite painful. You would likely regret the attempt,
she said, a hint of concern in her golden gaze.
Many of us don't believe you could survive it.
I will, I vowed. She put a hand to her chest and made a slight bow.
Then Zoria be with you.
Zoria was their dragon goddess. Relief swept through me for her to invoke such a mighty name. Thank you.
I'll escort her to Xanath now,
Aidan announced.
No.
Nanak gestured at Cade.
Your uncle may take her to the Sorcerer's Tower while we speak alone. I have a mission for you that will require leaving first thing tomorrow.
Oh, Lord. He just couldn't stop giving us more bad news. Tomorrow? I gasped. Where are you sending him?
Texas.
The Pendragon made a gesture toward the door.
Now, go. You must begin your training this very hour, if you're serious about it.
I shifted from foot to foot, wanting to stay but knowing I had to go. The Pendragon made a good point. I could find out about the trip to Texas later after I got my first training session. To annoy Nanak, though, I kissed Aidan on the cheek. A slight growl came from the direction of the desk as I pulled away. I didn't bother to look in that direction, as a grinning Cade took my arm and guided me through the door. Just before we closed it, I glanced back at Aidan. His expression showed concern as he watched me go, not giving me much comfort. We'd had months of peace, aside from my hunts for pure dragons, and enjoyed a relaxing winter together. But spring was here, and things were already heading toward full-scale chaos. I prayed these latest revelations weren't as dire as they seemed. Chapter 4. Aidan. The Pendragon waited until everyone left the room, the silent elders the last to go, and shut the door firmly behind them.
Tomorrow you will travel to see the Feygood, and coordinate efforts for the upcoming war.
You want me out of the way?
Aidan stated matter-of-factly. He wouldn't pretend he didn't know what Nanak was really doing. It had only been a matter of time. Any wise Pendragon kept the competition for leadership far from them, even if the potential competitors had no desire to take over their position. That could always change. Most would kill off potential rivals, aside from offspring. But luckily, Nanak wasn't that extreme. He'd been rather accommodating for Aidan and his siblings, until now. The Pendragon gave him a tight-lipped smile.
I am aware tradition dictates keeping you out of the way. But you are also the best qualified for this job, or else I would not give it to you.
Aidan had negotiated the treaty between their clan, the Taugud, and the Feygud, and he had a solid relationship with the current leader and her son. He couldn't argue that point.
Fair enough.
He clasped his hands behind his back.
What are my objectives? Find out how many of our warriors they will need, though we cannot spare more than 350. Also, get a timeline of when they wish to attack, details of locations, and other resources they will require.
Aidan nodded.
Anything else? Falcon and Phoebe will go with you.
The Pendragon settled into his chair, a cumbersome yet finely crafted piece of woodwork he'd added after taking office.
Use your sister as a messenger to report back to me everything you learn, but keep Falcon by your side at all times. I suspect Hildegard has a mission for you, and I want a shifter watching your back who you can trust.
He doubted the Feygud or their Pendragon Hildegard would be that much trouble, but Aidan appreciated the extra support. Of course, his sister was a rival for the Pendragon's position the same as him. Nanak no doubt seized on this excuse to keep her at a distance as well, taking two of them far away. Phoebe was trustworthy, though, and it would be good to have her for the trip.
This war will cost us, whether we win or lose,
Aidan said, needing to state the obvious. Nanak rubbed his neck.
It will delay our plans to the north. But expanding our territory further into Oklahoma City is not a high priority for me. We have more than enough land to manage now. The real trouble is that this war comes when I'm not confident with the stability of our borders.
Aidan shared the same worry. Their clan currently had a little over 800 shifters, spread over more than 10,000 square miles, though most lived at the fortress. Considering nearly 200 members were either too young or too old to fight, it made guarding their lengthy borders difficult for the remainder, while also supplying an army. Many female shifters of the Taugud had also become pregnant or recently given birth, since their diet had become more nutritious and stable this past year, increasing their fertility. None of them would be able to fight for a while either, except for defense if it came to that. But as the new members they produced continued to be born and grow up, they would provide more warriors for the future. The only trouble was, it would eventually increase the need for land. That wouldn't be tomorrow, though. Aidan's father had put a higher priority on that than necessary when they first arrived.
At least the Feygud will have our backs after we help them with this war.
Aidan pointed out.
That will make a difference until we get stronger. True.
Nanak rubbed a hand through his short black hair.
But none of the Torakin are at their best. All the dragons are scrambling to settle into this world and fortify themselves after centuries of decline. Speaking of which, the illness spreading among the Shadowin is getting worse. I fear it might strike us next. I'm well aware of it, but what have you learned?
The Pendragon asked, knitting his brows. Aidan fought a grin.
Bailey has had first-hand experience with it for nearly a week now.
Many of the dragons she has fought in the north have sneezed all over her and gotten her quite messy. I had to clean her up before bringing her here.
Nanak's lips twitched and a gleam entered his eyes.
I wish I'd seen that. I don't think she's very amused with the problem. I imagine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.